Welcome to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today on this live edition, July 28th, 2015, Tuesday. We're going to be talking to Alex Jones later in the show. He is, of course, in Europe investigating the globalist takeover there. He's in London. Rob Dew has arrived there. They're going to be joining us live later in the show, as will Paul Joseph Watson. And we have a guest in studio, Abby Johnson. She was a Planned Parenthood Employee of the Year back in 2009. And then she saw something that made her quit and become a whistleblower. What she saw was an ultrasound of a baby recoiling in pain from the procedure that they told her the baby did not feel. It's just a fetus, right? Look, you can call it a fetus, you can call it tissues, but it's baby parts. This is not a gray area. This is a black market. We have another video today that has come out from the same whistleblowers that have been going around doing these sting operations. They are not a hoax. This is a sting operation. The Planned Parenthood people, the liberal media have been pushing back saying, this is a hoax, this is a setup. Look, if you catch somebody on camera dialoguing like a supervillain because they're engaging in criminal activity and they don't know that you're recording them, that's a sting operation. 60 Minutes used to do that when they did real journalism. They do that all the time. The law enforcement does that all the time. They're constantly doing that because people don't confess on camera to crime unless they don't know they're being recorded. And of course, how does the GOP leadership react to this? Boehner says he needs more facts. Well, we've got more facts today. We're going to give him more facts. Maybe you should start sending him some facts. I was just amazed to see The Hill put out a video of an article talking about how Boehner cried when he did a Golf Channel interview. He can get so sentimental about golf, but he doesn't give a rip about the children who are being torn apart and sold for profit. That's the kind of leadership we have in this party. Those are the people that you voted for. It just shows how broken this whole political system is. We're also going to look at politics. We have a segment today, something I've been wanting to cover since Sunday. It's something we talked about on the nightly news last week when the story first broke. I think it was Friday. We saw this plan. Actually, it was a study done by the Department of Defense about what the future battlefield would look like in 2050. I've thought about it all weekend. It's bothered me so much. I want to talk about it on Sunday. And I want to talk about it yesterday, but there's been so much news that we didn't have enough time to talk about. There's been a lot of news lately, especially over this weekend. We've had top scientists, very well-known scientists. This is not a conspiracy theory, folks. We've been talking about this for years. It was dismissed as a bunch of tin foil hat conspiracy theory. We'd seen too many Terminator movies. Look, Elon Musk is funding millions of dollars because he's concerned about artificial intelligence being a runaway technology. We've got killer robot conferences popping up all over Europe. And of course, people are maybe starting to get concerned about what could happen with genetically altered humans. And of course, there's always the concern that these genetic modifications might get out of control and cause mass death in terms of bioweapons, because it's our own CDC, the Center for Disease Control, is actually the Center for Disease Propagation. These people, many of them, you'll see them wearing military uniforms, these people who work for the CDC. They are bringing in deadly bacteria. They're weaponizing the deadly bacteria. They call them select agents. Who are they selecting these agents for? When you combine that with genetics, is a very troubling scenario. And of course, they enhance them with gain of function to make them more deadly, easier to transmit. So we're going to look at how these trends are converging into the future battlefield. Killer robots and genetically engineered superhumans. Stay with us. It's an exciting show today. We're going to be joined later in the show by Alex Jones. He is in Europe. He is looking at the globalist takeover there right now. They are in London. He's going to be calling in. So is Paul Joseph Watson later in the show. And today, of course, we've had yet another Planned Parenthood video, undercover video, sting video. As I said in the last segment, it is not a hoax, as the liberal media is trying to cover for this. It is a sting. You understand the difference, right? when somebody is engaged in criminal activity, when they're monologuing like a supervillain because they don't know they're on video, that is a sting. It used to be done all the time by real journalists. It's now being done by these real journalists who are getting it. It's done all the time by law enforcement. That's the way they capture so many people, because you just don't confess when you know the camera's on. This is an amazing video that came out today. These videos, this one is very, very disturbing, because in this particular one, you can see them picking through the baby parts. There are stills, there are videos. It is very disturbing. If you watch this, and if you have a conscience, if it hasn't been seared, it will bring tears to your eyes. But of course, Boehner can't cry about anything except golf. He gets on the golf channel, he gets moved to tears, but when it comes to these videos, he says he needs more facts before he can do something. It's just absolutely amazing. We're going to have Abby Johnson. I'm sorry. We're going to have Abby Johnson, and then we're going to talk to her. She's a former Planned Parenthood employee. She became a whistleblower. She was disturbed by what she saw. We're going to talk to her. We're going to try to get through this video. It's just, I saw it this morning. I'm sorry. And we're going to talk about some politics here in a minute. I just saw this story at the top of the news stack. Central Florida theaters are issuing an alert on safety measures, telling people to report suspicious characters. We are becoming a very, very paranoid society. Of course, they're not going to give people the ability to carry concealed. They're going to continue to make them gun-free zones. So, yes, there is an element of risk there. But I'm just reminded, in the last couple of days, I've been going around with my son trying to get saltpeter, potassium nitrate, because we're trying to use it as fertilizer for some spirulina that we're trying to grow. And of course, when we walk in, and we've gone to store after store, because nobody carries this anymore. I don't know if it's become, some of the people, we went to a drugstore, a small drugstore, not a big chain, and they told us, well, we used to carry it, but we had to stop carrying it a while back. I don't know if it was made illegal. I think they made it illegal in Canada. But they all say to us, what are you doing, building a bomb? And after hearing that about five or six times, I just wanted to tell them, if you really believe that was a fertilizer bomb, if you believe a fertilizer bomb could have taken down the Oklahoma City federal building like that by itself from that kind of explosion, maybe you should look at the blast pattern, because it's not a point source. It went across the entire front of the building. I remember when that happened. The internet, of course, wasn't around. I looked in the New American Magazine. They had a former retired, I think he was a brigadier general. His specialty was demolition. And he pointed out, you don't get a destruction pattern like that from a point source bomb. So, we've made everybody so paranoid. Everybody is concerned about that. I guess I'm on yet another list, because I'm going around trying to get fertilizer for spirulina. But that's the kind of paranoid society we live in. But then when you talk to people about things that are real, about their cars getting hacked, about their phones getting hacked, about the government looking at everything they do. Look at this article here. 950 million Android phones can be hijacked by malicious text messages. It was just a couple of days ago we saw that all Chrysler Fiat vehicles could be hacked wirelessly. So maybe we should be concerned about that. Maybe we should be concerned at least about the future of these wireless cars. If Android phones, which have been around for quite a while, it's a mature technology, again, they're still hacking them, putting in malicious text messages. So all they have to do is send you a text message, and they can hack your phone. They can get control of your phone. And it was very simple for these hackers on Wired Magazine to take over that Jeep. Let me tell you something. I'm not going to be getting behind. There's no wheel to get behind. I'm not going to be getting into a self-driving car without a steering wheel, without brakes. I will ride a motorcycle, I'll ride a bicycle, I'll ride a skateboard, I'll get a horse, whatever, I'll walk. I'm not going to get in a self-driving car, not ever. I mean, look at what we've seen in the past with people who have, in several cases, blindly followed Google directions or Apple Maps directions or, you know, some of these computer mapping programs, follow it right into the water. Follow it down a trail and get stuck in the woods and die or nearly die. Or in some cases, they went around all the signs, all the warning signs that told them, this road is closed, the bridge is out, don't go any further. And it's like, but my computer program tells me to go ahead. So they keep driving, they go around, weave around all the signs that are there for humans because they trust the computer so much and they drive off the bridge. There's a literal case of that, literally. A man and his wife, she died, he survived. But they just, he kept driving and drove right off of the bridge. You know, it's a perfect allegory for where we're going with these self-driving cars. People don't understand the imminent danger, and they don't understand where this is leading. They don't understand that this is a means to take over your control, control of your transportation, to control your movements. Understand that the interstate system was created for military purposes. That's why Hitler created it. Before the war, Eisenhower had written a small book about how difficult it was for him to take a group of military vehicles from one point in the Northeast to another point in the Northeast. And then when he saw the Autobahn in Germany, part of World War II, it's like, we got to do that. And it was military primarily. Of course, there's been civilian use for it all this time, but that's primarily why they built the Autobahn and the interstate system here. Control of transportation is a main means of controlling a country, politically, militarily, physical control. This is why we do not want to have the government controlling each and every vehicle. They may be driven by computers, but they're going to be controlled by government, a government that can restrict your movement for any arbitrary purpose. That's the bigger picture. The immediate danger is that it's going to drive you into a ditch or drive you off of a bridge. Or have some kind of a software error. I mean, who would think that a computer would have a software error? We're only supposed to worry about human drivers, not about human programmers. I've seen plenty of human programmers making errors. I used to be a programmer myself. I made plenty of errors. I would never trust a car that was driven by a program that I wrote. Okay, and I'm not going to trust a program that's driven by something that somebody else wrote. We ought to be concerned about that. But it's just like the situation that we see with guns. Situation we see with them looking at our emails, people can't see the long-term picture. They can't see how this is going to broaden out. And so they understand, some people are starting to understand the need for individual protection for firearms, but they don't understand the danger that gun control presents to the population. Of course, we have done many discussions and videos about that here at InfoWars. When I first got here, we did a video called Democide, talking about the history of how gun control has preceded mass murder by the government called democide. Of course, it enables it. So people don't understand that. And we're going to talk later in this program about a couple of emerging trends. Of course, we've had a lot of news in the last few days about genetics. Of course, we're told the good side of the genetics. And every technology has good and bad sides. How do we control that? How do we control robotics, for example, so that we don't have killer robots? That's been in the news a lot. And then, of course, there was a story at the end of last week on Friday. There was a release of a Department of Defense conference where they were looking at future war, the battlefield of 2050, 35 years in the future. What does that battlefield look like? It looks like your worst nightmare. You cannot even believe the scenario that they have proposed here. To give you a quick overview, and we're going to talk about this at the bottom of the hour in detail, because it is a convergence of these two trends of genetic modification and of robotics and AI. And they're going to converge these. They're going to push it. It's going to be an arms race. That's what everybody is concerned about with killer robots, is the arms race aspect of this. I've got to build it before the other guy builds it. And we push and we push and we push. We already spend more than every other country in the world on defense. Every other country in the world combined on defense, we spend more. We are creating the threats. Then we create the response, the counter to the threat. Then we create the counter to the counter to the threat. What is this for? We're multiplying death and suffering. The only people profiting from it are the military-industrial complex and the standing army. And we need to take a close look at where this is going, because in 10 years, it's going to be too late to stop this. It may already be too late to stop this. We need to understand where this is going. So we're going to talk about these converging trends of genetics and killer robots, because the battlefield of 2050 is going to be filled with killer robots and superhuman genetically modified warriors. These are not going to be Captain America. These are going to be Winter Soldiers, because they are going to get their hooks into their minds as well. We're going to create a super elite group of cyborgs who have implants in them, who have been genetically modified to withstand deprivation, to be super strong, to have equipment themselves. But for the most part, they want to make sure that these killer robots will be able to operate so quickly that they don't even want the enhanced humans to control them. This is called plausible deniability, or an alibi, depending on which killers you're talking to. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We are going to be joined by Alex Jones. We believe it's going to be at the top of the hour, next hour. He's in Europe, of course, investigating the globalist takeover. He's right now in London. He's going to be traveling to several of the nations that are currently in the sights of the EU Central Bank and the bankers there. He'll be going to several countries there. But right now he's in London. He's going to be calling in. We're going to be talking to Paul Joseph Watson as well. And Abby Johnson, a former employee of Planned Parenthood, a whistleblower, will be joining us live in the third hour in studio. Now, before we go back to the news, I want to let you know that this hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by our newest flagship product. That's Deep Cleanse. You'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com. It's an all-in-one total body cleanser that uses nanocolloidal zeolites. Think of those as super tiny nano-sized sponges and other organic ingredients to cleanse chemicals and toxic metals from your body. With all the toxic pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, and metals in the food supply, Deep Cleanse is a great way to fight back. Get your body clean with Deep Cleanse at InfoWarsLife.com. Right now we have it in stock. It's been selling out very quickly, as all of our new products do. I believe we still have some in stock. And right now we have free shipping through July. There's only 2 days left in July, so you've got 2 days to get free shipping. Again, that's InfoWarsLife.com, and that's the newest product, Deep Cleanse. In this segment, I'd like to talk a little bit about some of the political news. Of course, people running for president. It's interesting to see. Right now, we're not really getting much in terms of issues. We're seeing a lot of personalities involved. Camille Paglia has something to say about Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton and Solange. She says how Bill Clinton is like Bill Cosby. And I would also point out that Hillary Clinton is like Bill Clinton. The three of them are three peas in a pod. You know, when she gets caught with these classified emails, her flat-out denials, her parsing, her prevarication, it's just so much like Bill Clinton. As we pointed out, she says she did not have textual relations with those classified documents. It's not credible. 55,000 pages of emails on her private server is what she has turned over. We don't know how many she had totally, because, of course, it was her private email. They've only been able to go through 40 of those emails. They found, the inspector general has found, 4 of the 40 that he's looked at had classified material in them. But here's what Camille Paglia says about the character of these people. Talking about Bill Clinton, she says, the horrible truth is that the feminist establishment in the U.S., led by Gloria Steinem, did in fact apply a double standard to Bill Clinton's behavior because he was a Democrat. The Democrat president and administration supported abortion rights. Therefore, it didn't matter what his perspective was, because, of course, abortion is the ultimate sacrament to the feminists led by Gloria Steinem and others. So they didn't really care what he did to women, because they don't care what he does to small women. Why would they care what he does to adult women? She goes on to say, the fact of the matter is that Bill Clinton was a serial abuser of working class women. He had exploited the power differential even in Arkansas. This is Camille Paglia, a real feminist. She doesn't pull any punches. She tells it like it is. It's going to be very interesting to see what she says about some of these other candidates. But she pulls no punches when she talks about the Clintons. She says, my publicly stated opinion at the time was, I don't care what public figures do. It's their private life. There's a very sophisticated style about that among the French and so forth and so on. Well, yes, but the reality is that he was impeached because he committed perjury. That's the legal term for lying under oath. He's a lawyer. He's a president. He knew better than that. They say a cigar and an intern is certainly the opposite of sophisticated. Okay, he didn't get impeached because he was sophisticated. He got impeached because of sophistry, because of lying, because of perjury. It's a legal definition. He knows better. She says the Clintons are responsible for the destruction of Monica Lewinsky. Again, this is Camille Paglia. She says it's like something out of Wuthering Heights or Great Expectations, the way this whole thing has played out, the destruction of character. I think that's a very important thing. That's why I talked about what we know about Donald Trump. How did he get his money? Of course, he doesn't rely on donations like Hillary Clinton and Jeb Bush and these others, but how did he get his money? He was perfectly capable when he was building his casinos of throwing people out of their homes, using the government for eminent domain to steal other people's property for private use. I don't care if the Supreme Court said it was okay. The Constitution says it's not okay. It's not moral to do that. It's a lack of character when you make money doing that. And we still see it happening with the Keystone Pipeline Project. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be talking to Alex Jones. He's in Europe. Right now he's in London. He's looking at the globalist takeover plans. There's many different aspects of that. We've seen what happened in Greece. We also know what's happening with the transatlantic partnership, with the trans-Pacific partnership. As Alex reported yesterday, Obama is a hero in the British press. Why? Well, because he's pushing the transatlantic partnership, because he's telling the UK, don't leave the European Union. You're an important transatlantic partner. See, they don't want member states to start leaving the European Union because the European Union is a construct that is supposed to now be joined to the North American Union, to Asia. That's exactly what the plan has been for a very long time. That's what the Trilateral Commission talked about. That's the structure that they had, the three different regions then being unified into a global government. So we're going to be talking to Alex Jones from Europe. Paul Joseph Watson is going to be joining us. Abby Johnson, a former Planned Parenthood Employee of the Year turned whistleblower, is going to be talking to us today. And we're going to be covering this new Planned Parenthood video when she arrives in studio. In this segment, I wanted to talk about these emerging trends, the genetic modification. So many articles we've seen about this on Drudge and elsewhere over the last several days, as well as the concerns, the rightful concerns that many prominent scientists have about robots, killer robots, getting out of control, the militarization of artificial intelligence and robotics, the next generation, and how this is all converging in the Department of Defense's plans, their plans of how they envision the future battlefield, which is a combination of killer robots and augmented humans. Let's start with the genetics aspect of it. Of course, in the last couple of days, we had this story about how Google-backed Calico is partnering with Ancestry.com. And of course, this is going to beat the specter of aging. You're going to be able to live forever. That's the promise, okay? They're going to solve all diseases. They're going to give you longevity. And if you believe that, I've got a bridge I will sell you. Because if they were to crack any of this stuff, they're going to keep it for themselves. These are the same people who are radical depopulationists. These are the same people who have come up with Agenda 21. They want to confine people, the rest of the people, into small areas and keep the vast majority of the world off limits to them. But of course, there's also a very troubling aspect of this, that they're going into Ancestry.com and picking through the genetic information there. So that also brings up a very troubling, when you look at that Wired magazine article, I don't know what that's about. These eyeballs, there's like 3D eyeballs that are looking in every different direction, individual ones. It's very disturbing. And I'm not really sure what that has to do with DNA, but we're going to talk about that article at length as well. But they say, we've been looking at and frankly responding to inquiries we've had from a number of parties about ways that we can collaborate to take the data that we've aggregated historically. Understand, as Alex Jones has been pointing out for a very long time, they've been collecting blood samples at birth surreptitiously for a very long time throughout the United States. Why do you think they're doing that? Well, this is part of it, but they're also going through and looking at things like Ancestry.com, seeing who lived the longest, so they can take a closer look at those individuals who are descended from people who had a long who live for a very long time. Another example of this comes from Bloomberg Business. This came out in the last couple of days. Superhumans who are real, and their DNA could be worth billions. Exactly. They're talking about people who have a congenital insensitivity to pain, or people who have bones so dense that they can walk away from accidents that would leave others with broken limbs. Here's one professor of medicine in the Netherlands. He went into a community where he noticed that the population had overgrown skulls, abnormally large bones. He went to a town meeting and he asked if anybody had been in a major car accident. One man raised his hand. He said, "I was crossing the street with my brother and a Mercedes was coming and I didn't have time to move." And I said, "What happened?" And he said, "You should have seen the Mercedes." So they want to go through and they want to mine this information. So it's not just Calico, which is now associated with Google. It's also 23andMe, which was associated with one of the Google founders' ex-wives, I guess. So they split. So now they have two different startups. But there's many, many different companies that are doing this. Amgen just bought an Icelandic biotechnology company for $415 million a couple of years ago. What is this about? The disturbing thing about this is the money involved, of course. And in this Wired magazine article that we just had up on the screen a while back, that was talking about the Genesis engine, talking about new software that's come out. And they go back to a conference where they talked to a scientist. That was a conference 1975, 40 years ago. The biologists came together. They realized that they were able to do some things with the basic theory that had been discovered less than 20 years earlier by Crick and Watson about DNA. They realized they could have some practical applications. They could directly modify the genes of animals. They could do transgenic combination. In other words, not just selectively breeding your dogs or your horses or your cows for a particular effect, but going in and taking genes from one species of animal and combining them into another. And then going in and directly modifying the human genome or other genomes. But at the time, they said, we don't really have to. They were coming up with some ethics statements that were going to guide them. There wasn't any outside source that was concerned about it at the time, 1975. And so they came up with their own ethics statements that were really non-binding. They said, we don't really even have to worry about humans because that's so far off in the future. Take this to today, and that's the what that article is about. 40 years later, now things have changed considerably. They now have something called CRISPR, which is some software that lets them go in. If you've seen Jurassic Park, they don't really go into it in that much detail. In the book, they go into it in a great deal of detail. If you remember in the movie, there's the Asian scientist, Henry Wu. In the book, they explain in detail how he's got this software where he can repetitively go in with the fragments of DNA that they're able to recover. They combine them, of course, with amphibians. That's part of what goes wrong at Jurassic Park. Those amphibians then are able to change their sex and multiply in the wild. They had originally just created female dinosaurs to keep that from happening. But the other aspect of it was these partial fragments of DNA, they would be able to go in and repetitively change things. If there was a defect in the animal, they would analyze that. They would go in and change that in the DNA. They're now able to do that in real life. That's what CRISPR is about. The tools that they have now are so much more advanced than these scientists could envision 40 years ago. It has taken place at a much more rapid pace. But I want to go back to Jurassic Park, because in 1990, when Michael Crichton wrote the book, yes, it's entertainment, but there is some serious principles that are laid out in that. Let's go to the introduction, where he talks about the incident, what the whole book is based on. He says, the late 20th century had witnessed a scientific gold rush of astonishing proportions, the headlong, furious haste to commercialize genetic engineering. This enterprise had proceeded so rapidly with so little outside commentary that its dimensions and its implications are hardly understood at all. The biotechnology revolution differs in three important respects from past scientific transformations. He said, first of all, it's broad-based. He said, 500 corporations, he's writing this now in 1990, and this is factual. He begins the book with a factual statement of where it is and what his ethical concerns are about it before he gets into the fictional Jurassic Park. At the time he wrote it, 1990, he said 500 corporations spend $5 billion a year on this technology. They said, number two, much of the research is thoughtless or frivolous. You want to breed paler trout for better visibility in the stream, square trees for easier lumbering, injectable scent so you'll be able to always smell like your favorite perfume? Those may seem like a joke, but they're not. In fact, that biotechnology can be applied to industries traditionally subject to the vagaries of fashion, like cosmetics and leisure. It heightens concern about the whimsical use of this powerful new technology. And then third, he says, this work is uncontrolled. No one supervises it. No laws regulate it. But the most disturbing fact, he says, is that no watchdogs are found among the scientists themselves. It's remarkable that nearly every scientist in genetics research is also engaged in the commerce of biotechnology. There are no detached observers. Everybody has a stake. The commercialization of molecular biology is the most stunning ethical event in the history of science, and it has happened with an astonishing speed. He wrote this 25 years ago. Michael Crichton did. He was a very perceptive individual. A vast multi-billion dollar commercial undertaking and its origins can be traced not to 1953, but to April 1976. That was 1 year after this conference that the fellow who's relating this to in Wired Magazine talks about. So after they get together and say, well, there's certain things that we're not going to do, the next year, a venture capitalist and a biochemist from the University of California get together and create a new company, Genentech. He says it quickly became the largest and most successful of the genetic engineering startups. That is essentially what this Wired Magazine article is talking about. 140 scientists that gathered in 1975 for a conference. But he said 40 years later, now they're getting together in Napa, in California again, talking about access to this gene editing technique called CRISPR-Cas9. He says it's basically, the name comes from a description of the genetic basis of the method, and Cas9 is the protein that makes it work. He says these are monumental moments in the history of biomedical research. What could possibly go wrong? Michael Crichton talked about the thin intelligence of the scientist, saying, yes, they see very narrowly. They don't see the broad picture. They don't see the surrounding area. They don't see the consequences that are coming. Let me tell you some of the consequences that we've already seen. CDC to review oversight of bioterror labs after USA Today investigation. That was July 21st. We've had another article from USA Today today. Congress questions oversight of biolab safety at a hearing. Federal laboratories working with bioterror pathogens are the, quote, leading offenders repeatedly being referred for sanctions because of safety violations, yet regulators from the Department of Health and Human Services have largely responded with violation letters in their efforts to ensure safe operations. In other words, they're not doing anything. One of the congressmen, Tim Murphy from Pennsylvania, said, what we have here is a pattern of recurring issues, of complacency, of a lax culture of safety. This is the federal labs. This is not even the private labs. These are the federal labs run by the CDC who are bringing in deadly pathogens that are not native in America, enhancing them into bioweapons. They call them select agents. They call the enhancements gain of function to make them easier to transmit, more deadly if you catch the disease. Now, what could possibly go wrong? Well, we've already had, if you remember, there's a lot of stories about the Pentagon's anthrax blunders, shipping live anthrax through the regular mail system. That was a story in the last couple of weeks. That's one of the things that's brought this to light. Of course, USA Today, Allison Young is an investigative journalist there. She has been on this story. She deserves some kind of award. I mean, it is amazing how she has covered this. It's a one-woman investigative journalist effort here. She pointed out in previous articles that there's over 200 biosafety lab level 3 and level 4 throughout the country. And you can see the map there if you go to their site. And half of those, 100 of those, have had accidents. Bio level safety 3 and level 4. Now we've got an article up today at InfoWars. A university professor says that Ebola is genetically modified, a lab-made virus. And I want to ask you, if that sounds like a conspiracy theory to you, think about the fact that Tulane University was involved in an accident with Burkholderia pseudomallei, a deadly bacteria that was brought in the United States, not indigenous here, very small area of the world where it was found, really only two countries in the world where it was found. They brought it in here to make a weapon out of it. They were messing with it at Tulane's National Primate Research Lab, and it got out of the bio-level safety, it was 3 or 4 lab, got into the wild. It got into the 500 acres there. They had a scientist, multiple agencies were there. One of them then tested positive for Burkholderia pseudomallei. It's in the wild there now. Thank you, CDC. So it escaped. They still don't have an explanation for how it got out, in spite of many investigation teams there. We know that Tulane, same university, was involved in the Tuskegee experiments, deliberately giving syphilis to black people, telling some of them that they were getting treatments that already had syphilis and not giving them treatments. So we know that they're ethically capable of it. We know that they can have mistakes. And we know that at the time that we had this latest outbreak of Ebola in Sierra Leone, that Tulane University had a laboratory there working on hemorrhagic fevers. The Sierra Leone government believed that they were responsible. The Sierra Leone government threw them out. So I have to ask you, do you think that our government, do you think a government that funds abortion is morally capable of releasing as a test pathogens? You don't even have to take that as a theory. We've seen it happen. Happened in San Francisco. They released tests in the New York subways, in the Boston subways. They say they were benign. We don't know. We don't know what our government is doing to us. They've lied to soldiers about the effects of things that they've exposed them to, nuclear weapons tests. Then we have Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking and Steve Wozniak in the last couple of days saying, say no to Skynet. They call for an artificial intelligence weapons ban. And of course, there's many different aspects about this. There's a concern amongst many people like Hugo de Garis that we've talked about that generalized artificial intelligence may in fact recreate the Terminator scenario. This is not life imitating art. Understand that Hollywood is given these scenarios by people who are doing the research. They're given scenarios by the CIA. They're given research by the Department of Defense. They want to get you accustomed to the future. They want you to see all of the horror that they are planning. And then they want to wrap it up at the bottom with a happy ending so you don't get too freaked out and do anything about it. They just want you to get accustomed to it. They want to move the Overton window. That's what they're doing with these movies. So we see many people coming out, pointing out that this is a problem. We have the a campaign to stop killer robots that is going on in the UK. Now let's go to where these converge. Not only the automated, when I talk about killer robots, let me explain that. These are drones. These are machines. They're planes. They're tanks. There may be devices like you've seen DARPA funding that look like four-legged animals with knees going the wrong ways, running over all kinds of terrain, weaponized and able to kill without human intervention. Because you can wipe out a lot of people with plausible deniability if you release one of these things and say it was just the software. Stay with us when we come back. I'm going to show you how this all ties together in the Pentagon's vision of the future. We're going to be joined at the beginning of the next segment by Paul Joseph Watson. Alex Jones is also going to be joining us from the UK. Alex, of course, is in Europe investigating the globalist takeover. He's going to be telling us what he's seen. And we have Paul Joseph Watson, who's going to be talking to us about his article, for one, bank tells a third party when customers have physically visited the bank. Yes, they're spying on you everywhere. Now, I want to get back to the future of warfare. Before I do, I want to let you know this half hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. For me, I take it every morning. It's very easy to take a lot of supplements in liquid form. X2 is in liquid form. It's a great way to get your iodine. It's something that you need to have as part of your daily nutrition. It really works. I can tell you from experience, and of course, Alex has talked about this many times, you don't have to take our word for it. You can look at the 400 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of those people would recommend it to a family or friend. Right now, it is in stock, and right now, through the month of July, we have free shipping. It's a good time to stock up on this because it goes in and out of stock, just like all of our products. Again, two more days in July for free shipping. That's X2 Nascent Iodine. You can get that at InfoWarsLife.com. You can also see the 400 reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, getting back to these trends, what the Pentagon has done is they've looked at these trends, like we've been talking about, things that have really erupted in the news lately. A lot of people very concerned. Elon Musk, Stephen Hawking, Steve Wozniak, all people concerned, like Noel Sharkey and others that we talked to, Hugo de Garis, all concerned that artificial intelligence is getting out of control. Concerned about an arms race where you have autonomous killing machines that make their decisions without human input. It's just send them out and let them start killing in an area. And let me describe to you what this battlefield is going to look like, because it's not only the killer robots, which are the predominant factor there, but in the Pentagon's vision of the future, they also see augmented, elitist, cyborg superhumans, genetically modified people with implants connected to some of these robots, although most of them will be operating autonomously. This is a report that came out from the Pentagon, visualizing tactical ground battlefield in the year 2050. This is a report that actually was picked up. It came out of the U.S. Army Research Lab. It was picked up by Australian source. We picked it up from them. Not much coverage in the U.S. press. Let me give you the table of contents here. First of all, they broke it down into two areas. One of them is seeing, communicating, understanding, decision-making. The other one is actually the fighting aspect of it. Here's some of the topics in the seeing, communicating, understanding area. Let me ask if some of these sound familiar, if they sound like what we've been talking about with the Jade Helm programming with the special forces. Augmented humans, then automated decision-making and autonomous processes. Misinformation as a weapon? Yeah, that's what special forces and unconventional warfare are about. Misinformation as a weapon. Micro-targeting, that's what geospatial intelligence, human domain analytics, activity-based intelligence, that's what that is about, micro-targeting individuals. Cognitive modeling of the opponent, so forth. When we go to the actual fighting, listen to what they have. Ubiquitous robots. In other words, on the battlefield, robots are everywhere. Most of them killer robots making their own decisions. They work in swarms. As my son Lance said, nothing good ever comes in a swarm. Superhumans, directed energy weapons. That's things like laser beams. Force fields. Force fields. They're already working on them, folks. Other things like invisibility cloaks. It is a nightmare scenario. I don't have time to go into all of this, but we have to, as a people, come to grips with an out-of-control, militarized industrial complex, a standing army, and stop this before it gets to this nightmare scenario. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host in Austin. We're going now to Paul Joseph Watson, one of our reporters. Certainly, if you go to InfoWars.com, if you're familiar with our site, you have seen Paul Joseph Watson's stories many, many times. And Paul Joseph Watson is going to be joining us from the UK. We're also going to be joined later in the hour with Alex Jones, who is also in the UK, doing investigative reporting, going throughout Europe. Let's go to Paul Joseph Watson. Paul, we have a report from you about a bank telling a third party whenever customers are physically visiting that bank location. Welcome, Paul. Tell us about that.
Hi, David. Yeah, we're here live in the City of London. And this story revolves around an email that I received last night from an individual who is a customer at Halifax Bank, which is one of the big banks here in the UK. And he said that he had received a call from a market research group asking him why he visited the bank the previous Friday. So we asked the research group involved, we asked Halifax Bank what was going on. Turns out they've got a policy whereby they are tracking people's physical movements when they actually visit the bank. And this individual in question didn't even speak to anyone in the bank. He merely visited the ATM machine to make a cash withdrawal. So it turns out that they're passing on this information, the bank is, to this third party, and then phoning people up and asking them, why they visited the bank, and you know, under the guise of customer service.
Yeah, obviously under the guise of creepy customer service. It's definitely creepy that they're following everything that you do. Of course, that's what people need to understand. I hope that people are starting to understand the total surveillance that we're under, the creepy intrusions into our private life, and how we have so many different corporations, as well as a thing that concerns me even more so, I think, is what the government is doing in terms of mapping our locations. We know that that's there. It's just that they're not as obvious about it.
Well, yeah, and we know from Bilderberg that one of their prime topics for conversation, we reported on this before the conference, was capital controls. So you've got numerous individuals in top finance industry in places like Germany and elsewhere calling for the abolition of cash, calling for these capital controls to be imposed on customers. So we're being treated with more suspicion. You know, HSBC recently introduced a policy which caused massive controversy, whereby if you withdraw more than £5,000 in cash, they need documentation as to how you're going to spend that cash and why you're withdrawing the money. So as the controls become tighter on us, the controls, the regulations become looser on banks like HSBC, and they get away with money and drug laundering.
Oh, absolutely. They try to make it
under intense control.
They try to make it look, Paul, as if cash, the desire to have cash or the withdrawal of cash that you put into the bank that was vetted when it went in, and then you take it out, that's a reportable event as well, because they want to make that look as if it's a criminal activity, as if you're engaged in something that is criminal. You're part of a black market, or you're a money launderer for drugs. But it's HSBC that actually did launder billions of dollars for drug cartels. They actually gave the Sinaloa cartel, the people that we've heard all this talk about, El Chapo, who escaped from prison. He was head of the Sinaloa cartel. They had their own private window at an HSBC bank where they could go with their cash to launder it. And nobody in the city of London went to jail. Nobody in the U.S. went to jail from HSBC. No individuals were fined. And it was a very, very small slap on the wrist for that corporation in terms of the profits that they got.
Yeah, and also with HSBC, of course, they help wealthy people hide taxes. So again, we're being told we need to be investigated for that. It's being covered up when it applies to them and what they do for their clients. So that's why people are really pissed off about that right now.
Yes. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. We've got Paul Joseph Watson reporting live from the City of London, right there in the Financial District. We'll be right back with Paul Joseph Watson and Alex Jones from London. Stay with us. Joining us in the UK is Paul Joseph Watson. We're also going to be talking to Alex Jones in the UK as well, also in London. But joining us from the City of London, the Banking Center of London, is Paul Joseph Watson. Paul, we were just talking about the article that you have up on Infowars.com, bank tells a third party when customers are physically visiting those banks. We were talking about how they look at everything that we do. They treat as suspicious any activity of us handling cash that's being put into the Overton window as something that is criminal activity. It's either tax evasion or evidence of being involved in a black market, involved in the selling of drugs. And yet the giant banks like HSBC do launder money for the biggest of the drug cartels, and no one goes to jail, no one gets fined, the corporation itself doesn't have its charter pulled, they get a very small fine, even though they set up a special window for the Sinaloa cartel. El Chapo, the guy that just escaped from prison, was the head of the Sinaloa cartel, and they get their own private window. That's how pervasive the money laundering was inside of HSB. Nothing happens to these big banks. You're standing right there on the street in the middle of all these big banks that nothing happens to. And yet they want to know everything about us, all of the details of our lives.
Yeah, and remember that this was a $40 million fine, the most recent one for HSBC. Then they had three representatives immediately after that was in the news attending Bilderberg from HSBC, including one who was the head of the BBC Trust. So again, that cozy relationship between banks and the media, discussing how to put more capital controls on us while themselves getting away with these monumental crimes. So,
yeah, recap your story for those who are just joining us. A lot of people don't hear the first segment of the hour. Recap the events that caused you to write this article and question what had happened.
Yeah, I was contacted by an individual yesterday who said that he went to the bank to withdraw money last week, last evening, he received a call from this market research company, this third party, wanting to talk to him about his account at Halifax Bank. And they said, oh, we know you were at the bank last Friday, gave him the date and time, and he had only gone to the bank to withdraw money from an ATM. He didn't even speak to any bank employees within Halifax Bank. So we already know that, you know, banks are tracking when we use the ATM. But this is somebody who, they passed the information on to a third party. Now it's in a database. So they know physically where you're going, when you use the bank, at what time. Selling that information to third parties,
you know,
who then call people up and ask them about it.
I mean, Paul, that's creepy. Yeah, it is creepy. I remember a horror film. The premise was, I know who you are. I saw what you did, right? It's a prank call by some kids who are just calling people at random, and they call a guy who's actually a criminal. But this is the creepiness of it. That's essentially what this network research organization is doing. They say, hey, we saw what you did. We know who you are. We know when you did it, what you do. What's even creepier about this, and what people need to understand, is that this is part of a trend of the surveillance state of law enforcement. It's called pre-crime profiling. That's the sinister aspect of it. And the aspect that everything that we do is available to them for micro-inspection, for data mining, for analysis, and putting all this together and seeing who pops up in their database as a criminal, perhaps. And that has a lot of potential, a lot of dangerous potential for people being falsely flagged as a someone who is committing a crime when they really aren't. And of course, we know what happens when people think that, when the government thinks that you're committing a crime, you're very likely to get SWAT teamed. Paul, I played a video yesterday of George Galloway, who's running for mayor in London, and he was standing on the street in the interview, and he had Max Keiser next to him. He said, a lot of people appoint czars. If I get elected as mayor, I'm going to appoint my Keiser. And the whole point was, he was talking about, he and Max Keiser, using blockchain as a way to audit the City of London, pointing out that the City of London has its own special police force right there where you are, just like the Vatican has its own Swiss Guards and everything. The City of London has its own police force, yet nobody ever goes to jail in spite of that, or I should say maybe because of that. But I thought it was a very interesting idea that they were talking about using blockchain, which is a technology that it is at the heart of Bitcoin. They were talking about using that to give us transparency into what the bankers are doing, into what the government is doing, into what happens with elections. We've seen a lot of articles in the last week or so talking about blockchain doing just that. And today, Paul, there was an article that NASDAQ, which is the technology stock exchange predominantly here in the United States, they handle, we have several different stock exchanges. Some of them are focused on commodities. Some of them are focused on the financial aspects or other businesses. But NASDAQ has a lot of tech companies. And so they're the first ones to do this. It was reported several months ago they were looking at using blockchain within their business model to make this more reliable, more transparent. And now they have announced that they are going to be the first major exchange operator to use the technology behind Bitcoin. So, Paul, do you think George Galloway and Max Keiser are onto something there in London?
Well, I mean, a lot of people have concerns about Bitcoin because they think it's going to herald the cashless society.
Yes. But
the thing with blockchain is it creates that ledger whereby you can go back and trace every single financial transaction. Whether they're going to allow that to be applied to things like, you know, high frequency trading, which is how a lot of this is done behind the scenes, that remains to be seen. I mean, I think it would be very unlikely. What we've seen with Bitcoin over the past couple of years is, you know, it started off as an underground movement adopted by libertarians, people with privacy concerns. Now you've got a lot of the big banks, especially in London, because I've spoken to the Bitcoin entrepreneurs that actually go and meet with them on their massive yachts. They want to co-opt that. George Osborne, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, wants all that to be regulated. So they're prepared to let it exist, but under the purview of their watchful eye, which of course completely defeats the original objective of Bitcoin, which was to provide complete anonymity and financial freedom. So whether you can strong arm that into a system of regulation controlled by governments and banks remains to be seen.
Yeah, well, what they're talking about doing, and of course, I share your concerns too about some aspects of Bitcoin. I don't fully understand it. I don't fully understand blockchain. But of course, as you mentioned, blockchain is the technology at the core of not just Bitcoin, but of all the cryptocurrencies. It's a way of providing an audit trail that is at the same time provides some anonymity, but also provides transparency. And that's why people are looking at it as a means of trying to audit, for example, elections, where we could look to see how votes were cast, or have some better way to audit the voting trail rather than counting hanging chads and that kind of nonsense. I have concerns about electronic voting as well, because there's other areas. There's so many different areas where they can come in and they can game the system. I understand all of that, and I'm not advocating that for people who's going to write letters to us. Frankly, I would rather see a paper trail, even with the hanging chads and everything else. I'd like to keep it secret, above board, and keep all that stuff together. But then, of course, you still have the custody issues, the counting issues, the auditing issues, and you can still stuff a paper ballot. Nevertheless, they're looking at this Bitcoin thing and the blockchain that is the heart of all of these cryptocurrencies. It's interesting to see people talking about using it as a means to give us transparency in a lot of places where we know there's a lot of skullduggery going on, like Wall Street, like the City of London, to open that up to some transparency. I'd like to talk to people who are knowledgeable about this and let them make their case for it, because I quite frankly don't understand it, but I think it's an interesting idea.
Yeah, and the other thing is, you know, talking about cashless societies, we've got people within top finance ministries in Germany and places like that openly calling for a cashless society, for people to have government-controlled bank accounts where they have to get permission from the government simply to withdraw money. If you think about that to its logical conclusion, a cashless society, people would, if there's one issue which people would completely revolt against, that's it, because it would create complete chaos, especially in its early stages.
Yes.
So if you've got nothing to replace it with, it could cause bedlam.
And that's what people's concerns are about Bitcoin and some of these cryptocurrencies, is the fact that it conditions people to a cashless society. And of course, even if you don't have a hacking situation for your, you know, that can be stolen, just like the cash can be stolen out of your mattress or stolen out of your account by an unscrupulous broker. You can be stolen from in any number of ways, but still the fact that everything would be there electronically allows them so much control over your life. And that's what they're seeking in every one of these aspects. It's just like we were talking about earlier in the show. The dangers of driverless cars are not just the imminent danger that the thing may malfunction and drive you into a ditch. The greater danger is the control that it gives a few people over your life in terms of where you can go, places, and do things. And that certainly is true of a cashless society.
Yeah. You mentioned the Google car, and that's, we talked about it briefly yesterday. The main ethical concern, of course, is if you're driving down the road and there are two choices, you can have an accident, a wreck, save yourself, but kill a child who's playing on the road. And the AI is going to come in and make that decision to kill you and save the child. So that's a whole ethical consideration surrounding AI that people really need to debate and sound out before we get those, before we get that technology implemented. So,
yeah, when when we talk about a cashless society, when we talk about driverless cars, we're talking about a society where liberty has really been removed, where you are being constantly monitored, constantly controlled. Both of those are controlling technologies, and I agree with you. It's not clear to me when we look at Bitcoin whether that's going to be something that is going to, certainly it is a way to get around the central planning and the central banks. That's a good thing. But is it going to, it's got negative aspects in terms of the cashless society, in terms of being able to lose all your money if it's a grid down scenario, if they take down the internet, if they physically seize the servers of key nodes and take down the internet. I wouldn't put that beyond their capability to do that. We're going to go to break, Paul, and we're going to come back with Paul Joseph Watson. Also going to be joining us is Alex Jones, also in London. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us. Alex Jones here reporting live from London, England via landline telephone. Paul Joseph Watson via video Skype with Rob Dew. We're both working on different stories right now that tie into the same overall theme. And I'm going to be breaking some issues down this short segment. Next segment, we're going to come back and have a wider discussion with David Knight there in the InfoWars News Center in Austin, Texas, and also with Paul Watson, who I'll be meeting up with more tonight to compare notes. And by tomorrow, we're going to have several taped reports, TV reports that we're working on today. Big news information on attacks on free speech across the world, but also how the city of London within London is a globalist parasitic organization running the major narcotics trafficking, all of it. That's even been coming out in the news. And so big reports start rolling in tomorrow, Wednesday, the 29th of July, 2015. This, of course, is Tuesday, the 28th of July, 2015. And then we're going to be in Spain, then we're going to be in Italy, and then we're going to be even closer to the meltdown sites. But I want to go to Spain, and then I want to go to Italy, because I believe those are the next dominoes to be artificially flipped in this meltdown. Just look at the headlines here today in the Financial Times of London. Renewed stock storm deals, blow to Beijing after action to halt route. 1,700 shares fall by 10% as startled bidders retreat. Bank and commodity sectors hit. The second largest drop in Chinese stock market history. We just had one 3 weeks ago, and now we've had another. There is no way this state-run system based on fraud can continue, and the globalists know that. They use the easy money, they use the liquidity, they use the power on the way up to consolidate control. Then on the way down, they'll call for global banker bailouts to then stabilize the system, holding us hostage. Just as we just witnessed with the EU last week, Hollande and all of them coming out, Merkel and Cameron coming out and saying, yes, the answer is basically strengthen the EU, get rid of what national sovereignty is left, and that will supposedly stabilize something designed to implode and then to be picked up by a larger corporate global government. I've got a lot of points I'm going to be putting out in the next few days in video reports, you know, HD on the ground, talking to the people, because I wanted to get out there and get human intelligence on the ground and to see what's happening from the UK right through to the heart of Europe. And we're also going to be sending our reporters more and more during these meltdowns that we're going to see happen in a cascade in the coming months to give people boots on the ground, eyewitness view of actually what's happening. But before we go to break and come back and get more into this and talk to David Knight and Paul Watson about it, I wanted to talk about USA Today, the UK version they have, and I wanted to talk about some of the other publications here that I've been reading. When you watch television, whether it's Sky, which is Rupert Murdoch run, or whether it's BBC that's government run, it is a Obama worship fest. You would think this man walks on water. And they run these headlines, just like in the U.S., they're totally deceptive. USA Today, Obama to press Ethiopia on terror war, saying they're not tough enough on radical Muslim extremists. Here's another headline out of the same publication. Obama addresses human rights ethnic divisions on final day in Kenya. And so he's telling Kenyans, marry your sons off to other men, but be nice to the Muslims who are blowing up people and shooting up shopping malls. But then separately, he's saying Ethiopia isn't doing enough on their terror war. Here's the bottom line. The West is funding radical jihadis all over the Middle East, all over Africa, to destabilize. And as we said in the Obama deception 6.5 years ago, he would then basically be the African face for the invasion and destabilization of Africa. That's what I said. It's what our experts in the film said. The film's free online. It's evergreen. It's more important than when we first made it. Send the link out to friends and family so they can understand, hey, these guys predicted this all before it happened. So thoroughly disgusting that he has his cousin and others, Muslim leaders, destabilized. Remember, his family's Muslim in Kenya. Destabilizing Kenya with the Muslim minority, attacking Christians, just like they'll use black against white or white against black here, because it's a racial division they can exacerbate. In Africa, it's religious manipulation. We're going to come back and break this down. Bottom line, world government's here, and it's about to get a lot worse, but we can stand up against it, and we've got some solutions. Stay with us.
As you heard in the last segment, Alex Jones is in Europe investigating the globalist takeover. We've seen what happened in Greece Who's next? Is it going to be Spain? Is it going to be Italy? Well, Alex Jones is there now. We're also going to be talking to Paul Joseph Watson. They're both in London at this moment, and Alex has some breaking news for us. Alex?
That's right. Paul Watson is working on big stories with the financial meltdown, attacks on free speech, where they're banning criticism of radical Muslims on the ground in London. His work was so important. We had one camera guy. I had them peel off this morning as soon as Rob Dew got here from the U.S. He came 2 days after me to go out and start investigating. Those reports will be up in the morning by showtime, 11 a.m. Central tomorrow. Then we're going to be into the continent of Europe. But the breaking news is this. Pulling back, there was a story at Infowars.com last night and today by Mikhail Phelan, who was able to speak to the leader of the hacker group that was able to get into Planned Parenthood, separate from the groups that have been getting into where they're vivisecting the babies, where they're exsanguinating them, removing the organs for sale. Not the same group that, you know, got them talking about Lamborghinis they want to buy and how they want to get top dollar, you know, for the baby parts and all the rest of it, or how they want to get a good deal on them to be able to sell them for higher dollar. No, this is hackers getting into their servers to then illustrate that, no, it's about making hundreds of millions of dollars a year on the sale of baby parts. I knew about this 15 years ago or more, and I would talk about it on air, and people just couldn't believe me. I knew about mobile execution vans in China 20 years ago, and people wouldn't believe me until it was in mainstream news a few years ago. So the average person just cannot believe that their neighbor has 25 dead bodies buried in their basement, or, you know, five people in the refrigerator like Jeffrey Dahmer, until it comes out. And that's what's happening with this tyranny. But the big breaking news is just this. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. And I put a tweet out this morning at Real Alex Jones simply saying, you know, this hacker is a person after my own heart, or somebody I'd like to, you know, basically hang around with, because you hack babies, we hack you. The globalists know, though, that when they put the screws to humanity, humanity's going to stand up. That's why they want totalitarianism to try to control us. It's never worked. It's not going to work now. And they're going to be hoisted on their own petard. They're going to fall in the pit that they've dug for us. And all of these digital panopticon surveillance grids that they've put in place to surveil us are simply backdoors for the liberty movement to go in against them. And we're going to see the fall of Planned Parenthood if we want to see it. You know, God gives us free will and gives us our destiny. Yes, darkness is growing. Yes, we're going under world government because we laid down and let it happen. If we stand up, we at least know more innocents will be saved no matter what happens in the final equation. It's the fact that we do the right thing on this journey is the real judgment that's taking place. But they just need to understand this new video is coming out. They've already admitted new videos coming out of them basically dissecting the babies. They know more videos coming out of them making money. They know that good people know the system has been taken over and are now going to take matters into their own hands. And real patriots are smart. Real patriots don't blow stuff up so we can get the blame for it. Real patriots go in with hidden cameras. They hack systems. They resist peacefully in the info war. But if the globalists want to push it, and get offensive and start arresting or killing patriots, they'll find out how good patriots are at fighting, and they'll find out our restraint has only been because we understand they want to have a physical war, and we're beginning to win the info war. But I wanted to salute Mikhail Phelan, but I mainly want to salute, and of course Mikhail would say this as well, this hacker group, the defense of the unborn, the defense of human life is what it's all about, and I love what the hacker said, the white hat hacker, the halo hacker. I want to coin that term, the halo hackers. The halo hackers said, listen, we only do this to people that are arrogant and out of control and delusional who need to be brought back down to earth. And that's what I say to the New World Order. You will destroy the planet. You will destroy yourselves. Napoleon, Hitler, all of them became delusional. You cannot be God. You are not going to win. Come back to earth. Come back to earth. Stop starting wars with Russia. Stop funding radical Islam and then thinking we're so dumb we don't know that you're turning it loose to destabilize things and kill Christians and non-radical Muslims and innocents everywhere, with Obama giving speeches to African countries about doing more to fight Islamic terror. That means let globalist military in to counter the terrorists they brought in. I mean, this is so obvious. So again, the good news is, And I talked about this some yesterday from a hilltop over Avebury. I walked into this pub, the only place to get food, in the middle of nowhere, with the biggest stone circle in the world around it, Neolithic, 6,000 years old. There's 15 people in there. I counted them. And like five or six of them were listeners. Then I walk outside, and I'm walking by a house, and locals were listeners. Then I ran into guys from Wales who were listeners. Then I announced I was there, and in the 20 minutes after I did that, and I walked back in, a fellow named Charles, who's actually in the new Star Wars movie, he was showing me stuff. He's a stormtrooper in it. They shot it here in England. He was in a nearby town and drove over to meet us. I'm not bragging about our show. I want to be clear. People who aren't well-known, whose faces aren't known, whose voices aren't known, but are patriots who love freedom, just patriots to God, patriots to common sense, patriots to the innocents, patriots to justice, patriots to God. When you're out there, you don't know that other people like you are everywhere. But when I go out in public, because I am known, it's a radar ping to let us know how incredibly awake people are. And I can go anywhere in the world, from fishing villages in Central America, like Roatan, to the middle of nowhere, south of London, 80 miles south of London. It is incredible. It is exciting. So all this other stuff is happening. So I want to say this and then go to you and Watson for some comments in this segment. I'm going to punch out till tomorrow. I'm going to be doing lengthy Skype reports, tape reports. I'll be on the show a lot more coming in the next few days. But David and everybody are just doing an amazing job, and this whole lineup of guests. But it's such an exciting time to be alive. We are down to earth as just decent people that just love justice. We just love common sense. We just love order. We love freedom. We love free will. We're down to earth. The globalists think they're God, so they've taken over. So we need to be down to earth, but also above it all and realizing what a joke the globalists are. They're the opposite. They're not down to earth. They're incredibly ignorant in their own world. So that's basically my take on that. I know Paul's got breaking news. You've got breaking news. So much is happening. But this is just devastating victories to show how these ghouls at Planned Parenthood are literally being destroyed right in front of us. I can feel their political annihilation right now. The fact that they're not providing women birth control. They're not providing women medical care. They're providing evil and anti-human wickedness with these companies raising money with their victory campaign for Planned Parenthood with chunks, simulated chunks of baby strawberries in vanilla, and women wearing shirts. I had an abortion. You learn they're into the occult, and these people crawling out from under things, screaming "I love Satan" and spitting and frothing. This is a spiritual dimensional battle that we're facing. And we're not going to find the solution in these controlled churches. We're going to find it in our hearts and minds with a connection to God and the universe. And I can feel, as evil rises, I can feel good rising up to meet it. It is an epic moment. Paul Watson, I want your take on that. Then I want David's take on it. But I'm telling you, I can feel the energy. Watson, how exciting is it? I know you get recognized a lot now in the UK as well. Our reporters do. That shows there's an awakening taking place.
Oh, Alex, I got recognized in Austin when I went over there last year by, literally every Uber rider driver that I got in. They recognized me. Here in London, we were walking down the street just on the way to film these reports, and a cabbie called us over and said, hey, and he had an InfoWars sticker in his taxi. We had a conversation with him and got it on camera as well. Just doing this live show right now, we've had people walking past coming up to us and recognizing us. So,
Enemy is not going to tell us that we have strength. They're not going to tell us there's good in the world. There is good. The goodness is great. Evil is weak. I'm sorry. I just have to rant.
No, it's important to emphasize that people are out here and they're aware physically, because the internet is a kind of a vacuum where you don't really know how much of an impact you're having. Obviously, you can go by traffic stats and video views, but to actually see it in person and to meet people who are engaged and aware is really a great fillip, is a great boost for what we
do. And we're all brothers and sisters at a spiritual level together. That is a communion, a kinship that is beyond anything the New World Order can offer. Money, power, sex, none of it compares to the fact that we're all brothers and sisters together in this great fight.
No, exactly. And, what gives me great enthusiasm and a great sense of accomplishment is getting those big stories out that reach a lot of people and really touching them at the base of you know, the understanding of liberty and human freedom that we're trying to promote.
So, doesn't it feel good to just strike at the heart of this evil and to see the evil being defeated? Then we only wish other people would realize the power they have. Paul, I want you to come back and comment on that before you leave in 3 minutes. So I'm going to hand it over to David. But David, your comment on what he was just saying.
Yeah, it's very true, Alex. You know, we're going to have, in the next hour, we're going to be talking to Abby Johnson, who was Planned Parenthood Employee of the Year in 2009. She became a whistleblower. I want to get her story. We're also going to talk to her about this latest Planned Parenthood video. But yeah, it is true. I mean, it's something that I think is very interesting when you said that you had a stormtrooper come up to you, somebody playing a stormtrooper in the Star Wars film. In reality, he was somebody who loved liberty. And that's the great hope, is that even though we see people that we might not really recognize as being liberty supporters, that in reality, their heart beats in the same way that ours does.
Well, absolutely. Of course, he was like this big 6'3" guy, you know, in good shape. And he said, no, that's what all the stormtroopers were. And he even off record gave me a little bit of the inside intel about the new movie coming out. But all that's a side issue. It's just, it was a funny little factoid. And he was, you know, showing us stuff online and things about it coming out. That was just a little factoid about how they shot a bunch of it in London. But he lives out in the countryside and is a full-time extra. Just very, very exciting. Paul Watson, the accelerated financial collapse. Being here on the ground in Europe, you can really feel it. People say that the economy is a lot tougher than it used to be.
Well, yeah, that's the case. I mean, I was in Italy about 18 months ago, and you could see just by the general state of the country that it was starting to slip into decay. I guess in Greece, which you may be visiting later this week, you know, that's going to be more apparent. But I mean, going back to what you were saying before, I think it was Rob that asked the cabbie, you know, what value have you got from the information on Infowars.com? And he's like, well, it's stopped me getting into debt. So even from like a selfish perspective, just having the awareness of how the financial system works, when the next economic collapse is going to happen, where the dollar's going to go, where gold's going to go, you can even use that selfishly to your own benefit, which I know I've done that in the past. And, you know, that's a good thing for people to take better care of their families. So,
oh, that's a great point. The globalists offer ignorance and failure. That's why major corporations and governments, it's come out, listen to this show. It's not that mainstream media couldn't tell the truth. They know what's going on. They lie. We have the experts. We have the people on with the track record, like Mr. Dent, you know, last year saying, watch China melt down at the end of next year. And it doesn't mean we have all the answers. We're not even heroes. But we instinctively don't want to be slaves. We instinctively have a fighting spirit. We instinctively will not submit to tyranny. And we know we can win. I've been on this field for 20 years, folks. Ron Paul for 40, others even longer. I'm telling you, it doesn't have to go this way. And the reason I've got so much earnest in my voice is I say we're doing good, and we are doing good, but it's only because we're doing so bad that people are finally waking up. The Pope has announced world government. They've got carbon taxes coming in to shut down the economy. It'll kill over 1 billion people in the third world. And then that will flood the third world even more into the West to collapse us. The globalists are devilish. They are so evil. They are committed to destruction. And we've got to just grow up and admit that to ourselves. And I want to thank all the listeners and the amazing crew back in Austin, Texas. That's like our NASA command base, our Houston. You know, the InfoWars Houston is based in Austin, Texas, and they're there making sure everything happens. So they're the real nuts and bolts and the real heroes on the ground for everybody from CJ to Nico to just to Joe to just everybody in there to Matt to just everybody. I don't know if people want to be thanked on air, but this is an epic thing that's happening, and we couldn't do it without you, the InfoWarriors, and your prayers and spreading the word and your support. But it's really reaching critical mass. So I ask folks, have you told somebody about InfoWars.com today? Have you told them about other venues and other groups that are telling the truth? I'm going to let Paul Watson and David Knight have final comments towards the end of the segment. But the big reportage from the continent of Europe, I've just been taking a couple breaths the last few days getting geared up for this, starts tomorrow right through for the next week and a half. So I'm Alex Jones signing off for InfoWars.com, because if you're out there listening, you are the resistance. I salute you all.
All right. Thank you, Alex. And, you know, when you're talking to Paul, when you're talking about all the different taxi drivers that recognize you, I think it's very interesting. I think maybe perhaps they're awake because more than anyone, I think they may be seeing this new kind of corporatism that's coming in as they face Uber. You know, taxis have been very highly connected with government, very highly licensed. We've seen a lot of corruption in many different countries with the taxi unions and that sort of thing. Nevertheless, I see a lot of people who have sided with Uber, who are typically supporting the free market. Uber is not a jitney taxi company. The jitney taxi companies were minority companies here in the United States, Paul, that were going into areas that the regular taxi companies wouldn't go into. They didn't want to even go there. It was too dangerous. So you had a lot of small entrepreneurs who did it. They were ruthlessly stopped by the big taxi companies, the big unions, and government. Now, however, we see government partnering with Uber, which wants to take over all transportation, who wants to own all cars worldwide. I think that's why they call themselves Uber. He says private ownership of vehicles is going to go away when he gets self-driving taxi cabs. And we see all these articles being put out in the mainstream press about how self-driving taxis are somehow going to be the solution or a solution to global warming. So you've got these people who have, and especially in London, they've done so much work to get the knowledge and that sort of thing. And it's kind of this corporate crony capitalism where they're giving Uber a different set of rules than they give these other people. What are your comments, Paul?
It's very much monopoly capitalism with Uber. I mean, in America, I believe you've got maybe a couple of other similar companies. Lyft is one of them. Here in London, in the United Kingdom, there's really no other known companies. And of course, the result of that is the service becomes poorer and poorer. And the cabbie we spoke to earlier obviously hated Uber, as most of the black cab drivers do. But I've noted that definitely in London, the Uber service is very poor. They don't know where they're going. They overcharge you. And that's because they've got no real competition to keep that service up to a decent standard. So as long as that continues to be the case and government gets involved and it becomes monopoly capitalism, then that situation is going to get worse. So we need more competition for Uber.
You know, Paul, we began by talking about how creepy it was that the bank contacted this person saying that we know that you went to this physical location certain times. Uber was keeping what they called rides of glory. They actually blogged about it. They looked at people that were making a trip that they thought was an overnight affair. They kept records of people who would go to a location and then leave at 3 o'clock in the morning and go back to where they caught the tab saying, taxi, saying that that was possibly an affair. They actually mapped it out by holidays, by regional areas. Incredibly creepy surveillance. And that's what you get from
communist China.
Stay with us. Be right back. We've been talking to Alex Jones and Paul Joseph Watson in London. We're going to go back to Paul Joseph Watson in just a moment. Before we do, I want to let you know that this hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. That's how we fund the organization. And by our newest sleep support formulation, Knockout. You know, I was just, my wife showed me this article that quoted that for those of you who are having trouble sleeping, researchers say that 1 week of camping without electronics resets our biological body clock and synchronizes our melatonin hormones with the sunrise and the sunset. Now, that's great. I'd love to do that. I don't have the time to do that, however. And as my wife pointed out, she'd rather not have the bugs and mosquitoes. She'd rather take Knockout, because Knockout uses sleep-supporting ingredients like melatonin. Talking about resetting your natural melatonin, that's the substance that your body releases that time. So that's why young children can sleep so soundly, and it's also why older people don't sleep very soundly. They just take cat naps. You know, grandpa's always falling asleep on the sofa, and you got to keep waking him up, but he doesn't sleep through the night because as you age, your body's production of melatonin goes down. So Knockout has melatonin, but it has a lot of other things as well. Valerian root, L-tryptophan, and other ingredients to naturally help you to get to sleep easier. You know, many people use melatonin. We're talking about Alex being in Europe. Many people use melatonin to reset their body clock when they suffer from jet lag going to another time zone. You'll find that, L-tryptophan and valerian root and many other ingredients in our newest sleep formulation from InfoWarsLife.com, Knockout. And as a reminder, in July, we have free shipping, and there's only 2 days left of free shipping, and that's for all products at InfoWarsLife.com. You get free shipping, but that will be over in 2 days at the end of the month in July. Let's go back to Paul Joseph Watson in the UK. Of course, Paul, you haven't been traveling. Alex has. We were just talking to him, and he's going to be filing more reports this week as he's going through Europe. You had an article that we had not discussed yet that you want to talk about, and that's the controversy surrounding a Draw Muhammad contest. Tell us about that.
Yeah, this was basically the story of how political dissidents who may commit thought crime are now being kidnapped off the streets of Britain. There was an individual who was quite prominent in the anti-Islamic extremism movement who was going to attend a Draw Mohammed cartoon contest last week. The police rearrested him for a previous charge, which he had already been released for, in order to prevent him from attending this conference, literally just so he wouldn't offend Muslims. So that story, we've done a report on that outside Big Ben. That's a massive story. It's going to be up tomorrow before the show.
That's amazing. And, of course, we've seen a lot of comments from David Cameron, hostile to free speech, hostile to privacy. He wants to abolish any kind of encryption, as does the FBI here as well. They don't want you to have any kind of encryption. They want a backdoor into everything you do. They've already put the backdoors in. They're already listening to everything. But they want to make sure that we don't get people don't start using encryption widely. They want to make sure they can continue to get access to all of our information.
Yeah, and just one more thing on that story. There was literally a guy wearing an ISIS flag walking around the streets of London 3 weeks ago. He was briefly detained by police, questioned. They let him go, didn't even take him into the station. So you've got that happening. Then you've got people who merely planned to attend Draw Mohammed cartoon contest being abducted off the streets so as not to offend these Muslim minorities. So that's the state of free speech in Britain today.
Well, very much like what we saw here in the United States, of course, once we had that guy who was obviously had an Islamic agenda, a jihadist agenda, shooting up not one, but two military recruiting areas. They did everything they could to push that away, to deny that that had any kind of Islamic terrorist connection. At the same time, they went through weeks of demonizing all of Southern culture and the Confederate battle flag because they had a picture of a mass shooter who was reportedly on drugs. It's amazing to see the dichotomy. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host in Austin. We're going to have joining us in the studio in the next segment, Abby Johnson, a former employee of the year at Planned Parenthood. We're going to talk to her about why she quit. She became a whistleblower. We're also going to talk to her about this newest Planned Parenthood video. As Alex mentioned in the last segment, of course, Mikhail Thelen talked to, and we have an article up at Infowars.com, talked to some people who said that they have hacked Planned Parenthood's emails and website. They are going to be exposing some incriminating information. They say we haven't seen that yet. Let's talk about some incriminating evidence against Jeb Bush. This is an article that was up on the Drudge Report from Bloomberg Politics. Jeb Bush snares a Democrat money man on a tour of the Hamptons. Listen to the way this place is described. This is how the game is played by the oligarchy that we have, the Clintons and the Bushes. They say, behind a garden that's modeled on Monet's, this is presumably modeled after a famous painting, Jeb Bush addressed a lawn full of chief executives and hedge fund managers at an East Hampton, New York estate Saturday morning. That'd be out on Long Island. While the candidate is no stranger to courting wealthy donors, this time it was different. About half of the attendees were Democrats. This guy sells well, said Kenneth Lipper, a money manager and a registered Democrat who hosted the event. He said, virtually the only one left without writing a check was a buck deer that wandered past the group assembled on the wooded grounds. Amazing. And they point out that candidates are raising more money through super PACs, which can accept donations up to $1 million or more. You can donate $1 million. It seems to me, I remember Dinesh D'Souza got convicted of a felony because he donated $20,000 to a candidate. Isn't that interesting? And, of course, submitted for additional psychological evaluation. Nothing political about that, is there? That's how the game is played. These guys write the rules. They set it up so that the great big bees go through the spider's web, but the small gnats get trapped in it. Here's some more news about the political campaign. Lindsey Graham accuses Trump of appealing to the dark side of politics. Yeah, that's right. That Lindsey Graham, the merchant of death, okay, the lobbyist for the military-industrial complex, talks about Donald Trump saying that he's appealing to the dark side of politics. He says fellow Republican presidential Donald Trump is appealing to that dark side, should be avoided. He's appealing to fear and prejudice, and there's a market for that. Yeah, Lindsey would know. because Lindsay has made a career out of appealing to fear and prejudice. He knows there's a market for that. He knows where he can get paid by the military-industrial complex for creating wars, for creating fear, for creating this massive armament that we've got that we just talked about in the last hour, how this is careening off of the cliff, one more area that's careening off the cliff. Now, of course, Rand Paul is not getting the super PAC funding. He's getting most of his funding from individuals. And he pointed out that Trump is getting $1 billion worth of free advertising. This is on the Hill. He was on CBS's Face the Nation. He says, I think if you give a candidate about $1 billion worth of free advertising, that might help them to get their message out. He's not getting that kind of free advertising, and he's not getting the big bucks from the moneyed people like Jeb Bush and Hillary Clinton, but it's not just them, of course. Politico reports that the Koch brothers have now summoned Bush, Cruz, Walker, and Rubio to a Southern California confab because those are the guys that they know they can put, purchase, evidently. So that's just a note to people who are considering that. And, of course, we see Bernie Sanders visiting Louisiana. He's very popular with people because he seems to be plain spoken and out in the open. Nevertheless, you don't have to scratch him too deep to see gun control agenda. He wants background checks and registration. Here's a clue. Those things don't control guns. We've already seen that with all of these shootings involved. Okay? All of those techniques are for controlling people. Stay with us, right? When we come back, we're going to be talking to Abby Johnson, former Planned Parenthood employee. Only days after joining me in studio is a former Planned Parenthood worker, Abby Johnson. We're going to talk to her about her experiences, why she left, why she became a whistleblower. Before we do, I want to let you know that this hour of the Alex Jones Show is made possible by your support of our products, our high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com, products like Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. That is now back in stock. You can see we have over 400 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of respondents would recommend it to a friend or family. Let me give you a couple of the reviews so you can get an idea of what you can see there. This is from Jason in Auburn, Washington. He says, great product. I felt a mild detox on day two, a few days after that. It really clears up the skin, makes my mind sharper. I've been recommending it to people. I see it work. I remind people it used to be in bread and salt, but it was removed. It's the best way to get good quality iodine. Another one from Keebler in Sacramento, California says, I've started taking Survival Shield X2 one week ago, and after the first week, I've noticed more energy. And I'm not tired and groggy in the afternoon anymore. I've also noticed a cleaner dealing all around. I'm not sure what that means, but he's feeling much better taking it because we all need iodine. As the first commenter pointed out, it's something that used to be part of our food supplement. We don't get that anymore. It's a great and easy way to take it in liquid form. We sell out of Nascent Iodine frequently. It's available in stock. And right now at InfoWarsLife.com, we have free shipping for the month of July. That's only 2 days left on that free shipping. So you can get that. You can stock up on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine right now while it's in stock. Well, now let's talk to Abby Johnson. Thank you for joining us, Abby. Let me introduce you here. She left the abortion industry in 2009. It says she's known that her calling was to work with current and former abortion clinic workers. You've got a website, abortionworker.com. You've also got another one, and then there were none, attwn.org. That's not an Agatha Christie novel. That is the concern about the massive numbers of people that have been killed since Roe v. Wade, a number that's equivalent, really, to a 9/11 on virtually a daily basis, is what we've seen. And so I want to ask you, you were there, you started with Planned Parenthood in 2001, your bio says, you progressed the position of Health Center Director. They were giving you awards there, but what happened that caused you to leave?
So there were a couple of things that happened. One was that they imposed an abortion clinic quota on all of the facilities that performed abortion. So they told us you have to perform, you know, this many abortions every day, every month, in order to meet your goals, to receive your bonuses, to keep your staff.
That's very troubling because if you had somebody that was just a doctor, let's say that this was a doctor that did heart surgery, and they came into that doctor and they said, you need to do X number of open heart surgeries.
Right.
or else. I mean, you would expect that perhaps they're going to be doing open heart surgeries that are not necessary because it's profit driven.
Right. And abortion, and I can, you know, only really speak to my experience at Planned Parenthood, but it was very profit driven. So we were told at Planned Parenthood that we were to turn every client visit and every telephone call into a revenue generating visit. The only way that you can make money off of a pregnant woman at Planned Parenthood is to sell her an abortion, because they don't provide prenatal care, they don't provide any obstetrical care, and they don't help women with adoption services. So the only way you can make money off of a pregnant woman is to sell an abortion. And so it's not surprising that 92% of pregnant women who enter Planned Parenthood will have an abortion, because they are being sold a product. So that was the first thing. And that was concerning for me, because I really believe that at Planned Parenthood, we were there to help women, that we were there to reduce the number of abortions. That's what Planned Parenthood said, and I had believed it for 8 years. So this was concerning for me.
It was all about planning. It was all about family planning and making sure that every child is a wanted child.
That's right. That's what I thought. That's what I believed. And then, but ultimately I left after witnessing a live ultrasound guided abortion procedure take place on a 13-week-old baby. And I saw that baby fighting and struggling for his life in the womb, trying to get away from the abortion instruments. And I knew that I had been lied to by Planned Parenthood. And because of that, because I had believed that lie, I had lied to thousands of women who had come through my facility. And so I knew that I had to leave and I had to start speaking out. And that's what I've done.
You know, I told my wife many years ago when we were talking about this, we were in college when Roe v. Wade came out. And so when I looked at it, I was like you. I believed a lot of the rhetoric. I was somebody who always came to things from a libertarian perspective. So I thought, I want government out of the bedroom, out of the boardroom. I don't want them telling me how to run my life. Mm-hmm. And I still feel that way. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people think because of my position on gay marriage that I don't feel that way. No, I don't care what people do. I don't want to have any coercion, and that's what I'm concerned about with that. But with this, I thought, well, there's some question in my mind, and there's question in other people's minds as to when life begins. And so I was open to that until I ran for Congress, and I got involved in some debate forums and candidate questions, and people asked me about partial birth abortion, which was happening at the time. And I didn't know what they were talking about. And when I went back and looked at the procedure, I said, this is nothing but murder. I've been lied to, just as you were. And I told my wife at the time, it's interesting you mentioned that it was ultrasound, because I told my wife at the time, I said, the way we're going to stop this, because there's so much deception and lying going on with this, I said, the best thing that anybody could do, I know counseling is important, but I think the organizations need to start trying to fund a way that we can get better imaging of the baby in the womb. And now we have that. It wasn't funded by the pro-life people, but we do have that. We have 4D ultrasound, and people can see movies of their children in the womb.
Yeah.
We see National Geographic had a special where they showed dolphins and dogs and elephants in the womb, and I mean, you could see the detail down to the hair on these animals and everything. And we can see that detail now with 4G ultrasound. But this, the things that we're seeing now, the testimony of people like you who have worked there, the things that we're seeing now with these videos that are coming out now on a weekly basis, where they're talking about the things that you have said for a long time, whistleblowers have said, but to see the people who are the doctors, who are the head of the clinics, talking about how they're doing this for profit, negotiating the money there. Mm-hmm. It's just amazing.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I've said before that organ harvesting is a big business. Tissue harvesting is a big business. It's not just talking about fetal tissue here either. I mean, we're talking about companies like UNOS, who have millions of dollars of assets. People are profiting, organizations are profiting off of the sale and harvesting of adult organ donors as well. So, you know, we're not just talking about babies, even though in these videos we are, but I mean, this is a symptom of a larger problem, and that is the exploitation of life.
Yes.
Period.
And the modification of life, because we talked in this program earlier about the many articles that have come out, and of course, They're talking about the good things that can be done with it. They're not talking about the evil things that can be done with it. Right. They're not talking about what the Department of Defense is planning on doing with this. They're not talking about the possibility that they could make mistakes, technological mistakes that could go horribly wrong with people. They're not talking about people getting a hold of some of this genetic information and using it to target a particular population, which is what we know that Planned Parenthood, anybody who knows their history knows that that's what they were doing. It had a very, very much a eugenicist target behind it. So when we look at this and we look at the fact that they're harvesting this on the front end in this unethical way, it raises concern for me about how this genetic research is going to be used on the back end as well, because it's this fetal tissue, human adult tissue that they're grabbing. And the same people who would resort to getting baby body parts for their research are the people who are going to be producing these new genetic miracle drugs, we're told.
Right. And one of the things that's that is terrifying to me is that the abortion industry, it's not just the abortion industry. It is the abortion industry, but it's also, you know, I read somewhere that Texas Tech received a $3 million federal grant to do embryonic stem cell research, you know, harvesting fetal tissue and organs, you know, NIH. I mean, all of these different groups are collecting this tissue and doing, we don't know what with it. But the scary thing is that and really the manipulative, and I think one of the worst parts is that, you know, when we would talk to these women who were having an abortion, we would, you know, basically manipulate them into believing that by donating this tissue, they could be saving the lives of others.
Yes.
But in reality, we had no idea what that tissue was going to be used for. That was never disclosed to us at the clinic. It was just for a price. Mm-hmm. So we're going to pay you $200 per specimen, per baby, and you're going to get as many as you can. And then we're going to basically lie to our clients and say, oh no, we're you know, this could save the lives of other people, when really we have no idea what it's being used for.
Let's talk about that aspect of it too, because we talked about how, you know, you don't want to put a quota on there for cardiologists or for ontologists or whatever. And we've seen a recent example of a doctor who diagnosed people that didn't have cancer, diagnosed them with cancer so he could make money off of them. This is something from an organization called Bitch Magazine. That's their name, Bitch Magazine. Mm-hmm. And they say women should have the option to donate, but not to sell. Why would you not want women to sell it? Okay, well, the obvious question is you don't want to create an incentive of killing for profit. But that's precisely what they were doing.
Well, that's what abortion is, period.
Exactly, exactly. Stay with us when we come back. We're going to continue talking to Abby Johnson, former Planned Parenthood employee, and now a whistleblower. We're going to talk to her about what she's seen and have her analysis of this new video. Joining me in studio is Abby Johnson. Abby is a former Planned Parenthood worker. And of course, she saw some things there that were very disturbing. She became a whistleblower. She has a couple of websites. We're going to talk to her about her websites, what are there. But of course, Abby, what we were talking about just before we went to the break was why you would not want to allow the donors of either organs or of babies, aborted babies, to profit from this. It's obviously because you don't want to incentivize killing. You take organs from accidents, from car accidents or whatever. Sure. And so you don't want to create a profit motive for them to kill. And yet that is precisely what Planned Parenthood is doing. You said that when you were there, one of the things that raised a lot of alarms with you in that final year was the fact that they were giving you quotas and telling you that you had to turn this many people. So you were actively pushing for abortion, not just helping people to make sure that every child is a wanted child, as their slogan goes. It was simply about profit.
Right. And this is, you know, it would seem like if Planned Parenthood is receiving $200 per baby that they sell, that they would take that $200 off the cost of a woman's abortion, right?
No, no.
Oh, no, no. They want to double dip. They want to get money from both the abortion and the sale of her aborted baby. So, you know, and just you know, to give you some numbers here. So Planned Parenthood Gulf Coast is that's the affiliate I worked for, and they are one of the few Planned Parenthood affiliates that does participate in this fetal tissue research, harvesting of organs. So let's just say conservatively that they perform 50 abortions a day, 6 days a week. Okay. Now their quota is 75 abortions a day, 6 days a week. Okay. But we'll just be conservative and say that they perform 50 a day. And I'll also give them a break on the price and say that they're only getting $100 per specimen. Okay. Now, really, they were getting $200 when I was there, but we'll just say $100 on 50 abortions, 6 days a week. That's $30,000 a week that Planned Parenthood is receiving on the sale of human body parts, $120,000 a month. And yet they are still receiving more than $500 million of our taxpayer money.
Wow. And that figure you put out, you derated that by at least half.
Yes.
You knocked the fee down by half. You knocked the number that they were doing down by a third. Mm-hmm. So that's absolutely amazing. That's why it is so big. And that's why this lady who said, yeah, I want my Lambo. Look, it is profit-based. We know that.
Absolutely.
She was being sarcastic about it, but there is absolutely no question. When you look at the vast amount of money that's being done there, the way they push abortions. And yet we see this story here from the AP where the Planned Parenthood official has come back and says, there's no profit from fetal organs. Mm-hmm. No profit whatsoever.
Yeah, here's the thing that's interesting about that. So let's say they're charging $100. The only real cost for Planned Parenthood in all of this is shipping the specimen. So let's say it's, you know, approximately $5 to $10 per specimen that they ship. It's probably less than that, but we'll give them $5 to $10 per specimen. But they're collecting anywhere from $100 to $200, maybe even more, per baby that they harvest and sell. So
they're not just recouping their cost. And it was clear in that video that they weren't doing it because she said she didn't know what the costs were.
No.
And so she's negotiating a fee, but she doesn't know what her costs
are. That's
right.
Because there are no costs except for the shipping. But the law, the problem is with this in particular is the law, because the law allows this loophole. So the law says, well, as long as it's for, you know, you write it down, you mark it down for storage or transport or collection, preservation, whatever. As long as you mark it down as encoded as that, then you can charge whatever you want as long as the cost is not, quote, prohibitive. Well, prohibitive is completely subjective. So, you know, for me, a mom of five, that's the prohibitive cost is going to be very different than a $1 billion organization like Planned Parenthood. And what I've told people all along, ever since I left, is that if there is a loophole in a law that involves Planned Parenthood, they will find a way to blow right through that loophole. And that's what they've done in this situation.
And she said it. She said, well, no, you know, this would be against the law, but, you know, laws are subjectively determined and that sort of thing. And we've got Boehner, John Boehner, head of the GOP. Voters who voted for him want to not see the federal government funding this. They certainly don't want to see them profiting from the sale of babies that they have incentivized the killing of. Boehner says he needs more facts. Hey, send this video to John Boehner and tell him it's got the facts in there. He needs to take a look at this. There's no gray areas in this. There's no gray areas in a black market for baby body parts. If you can tell the difference between right and wrong, John Boehner. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Abby Johnson. We're going to take a look at the new Planned Parenthood video. And joining me in studio is Abby Johnson, a former Planned Parenthood worker who became a whistleblower. She realized that this was being done for profit as they pushed and gave them quotas, continued to push for this. She realized that this was not about helping people to make planning choices. It was about pushing abortions. And then she saw an ultrasound, saw a baby recoiling in pain when they told her that the baby could not feel pain at that age. Was it 11 weeks, Abby?
13
weeks. Okay. That was it for her. And so now she has a couple of websites. We didn't talk about those websites. Tell us briefly about that. It's abortionworker.com. Actually, it's the same website, abortionworker.com, or you can also get there with attwn.org. And then there were none is the acronym for that. But abortionworker.com will also take you there. What can they find there, Abby?
This is a ministry and organization that specifically reaches out to abortion clinic workers to try to get them out of the clinic, to try to get them on a path of healing, to get them other employment that does not destroy life, but preserves it. So far in the past 3 years, we've had 174 clinic workers leave and come into the pro-life movement. And that includes six former abortionists who permanently laid down their instruments and are now fighting to defend life instead of destroy it.
That's great. That's really great. Now, let's talk to John Boehner. John Boehner, who says there's not enough facts out of these videos to make a decision. John Boehner, who can get all emotional and choked up and cry at a Golf Channel interview, but he can't get worked up about what we're going to see in this third video. Let's go to the law, John Boehner. That's your responsibility. 42 U.S. Code 289G-2, prohibitions regarding human fetal tissue. Here's what it says, John. It says, purchase of tissue shall be unlawful for any person to knowingly acquire, receive, or otherwise transfer any human fetal tissue for valuable consideration if the transfer affects interstate commerce. Now, they have exceptions to valuable consideration. They say that doesn't include reasonable payments associated with transportation, implantation, processing, preservation, quality control, or storage. So they give themselves some wiggle room here. They create an opening, which Planned Parenthood tries to exploit. But let's look at video number two's confession. And here's the transcript. This is the one, remember, this is the Lambo doctor. At one point, and this is a quote from the video, she says, and the mechanics of it was that Heather, a Novogenics person, would come to the site and our staff would sign the patients up and get their consent. Then Heather would look at the tissue and she would get what she required. So logistically, it was very easy for us. We didn't have to do anything. We did not have to do anything. Hear that? So there was compensation for this. So she came to the site. She picked out what she wanted. She took it with her. There's no transportation involved there. They did not have to do anything, but there was compensation involved. And there was a discussion as I was leaving. So they've been paying by the case, and there was some discussion about doing it in a different way. I don't know what you're used to doing, how you're used to doing compensation. Patients don't get anything, of course. All right, now, let's talk about this again. Remember the exception of valuable consideration, John Boehner, is transportation. Was there any transportation? No, Heather took the parts with her. There wasn't any implantation going on. There wasn't any processing by Planned Parenthood that they would get paid for because Heather would look at the tissue and take out what she desired, okay? There was no preservation of the tissue. She's taking it right then. There's no quality control or storage. She's taking the stuff right then. So, John, why don't you investigate this? Why don't you do something about it? Instead, we've got the leadership of the Republican Party shutting down Rand Paul, shutting down Mike Lee when they tried to defund Planned Parenthood. And it's not just John Boehner. It's also Mitch McConnell. Mitch McConnell. So you've got Cruz, you've got Lee, you've got Rand Paul trying to shut down the funding of this. Not even talking about doing a criminal operation about this, because I don't guess we can get the Department of Justice and Obama administration to go after somebody for murdering babies and selling them off wholesale, taking specific orders, as we heard the first video. She's saying, well, you can order it a la carte, essentially. You know, you tell us what you want. We'll talk to them. We'll make sure that we don't crush the parts involved. We'll make sure that we put it in a breech presentation. That's a hallmark of partial birth abortion, which, by the way, is illegal. But they do that so they can preserve the body parts. Your comment, Abby.
Yeah, I mean, I think that I'm glad that these videos are coming out. I think many of us have been talking about this for years, but I think for some people, it took hearing it from them directly, that this is happening. This is a process that Planned Parenthood is involved in, that other groups are also involved in. Hopefully it wakes people up because really the travesty is not them selling the body parts. The travesty is that an innocent human life is being killed in the first place.
Exactly.
But if it takes this to wake up some Americans to really this modern day Holocaust that we're experiencing, then so be it. I hope this is what it takes. I hope that this is what it takes to get people motivated to get out there and do something. And
well, it's like it took a partial birth abortion to wake me up.
Sure.
To get me to pay any attention to it. I never had to make that decision, fortunately, in my life. But I was willing to let other people make this decision. I'm not willing to let other people make the decision as to whether or not they want to kill babies.
Right.
I'm not willing to do that. That doesn't fall into my libertarian philosophy that you can take innocent life.
Well, you're just
a
bigot.
It does. But you know, it took that. It took that. And of course, why were they doing partial birth abortion? Well, we know because of the first video. She's talking about how we present it, you know, in a breech birth position. That way we can get to the valuable body parts without, you know, tearing everything apart. So that was a hallmark back then, 20 years ago, that, you know, they were they were doing this partial birth abortion so they could preserve and sell the body parts because they wanted another profit center. Let's take a look at this video that was released today now. Let's go to this first clip, and I think it's very powerful. Now, you're not going to be able to see this if you're on radio. Go ahead and run that clip, and we'll talk about this while it's on there. When they pull this clip up, they say, "What do you see?" And they show a baby, hands, legs, heart, eyes, okay? And then they say, "What does Planned Parenthood see?" And they put dollar signs over all these different body parts. That's a very, very powerful image.
Procure, they would get a certain percentage.
And then I want to go to this. Let's go to this next clip that we've got here, guys. This is, let's go ahead and run that next clip.
And then I see someone come in with a bottle of something and there was blood in it. I'm like, okay. And then they went over to the sink and they emptied it out in a strainer and put it on the pie dish and lit it up. And I'm like looking like, what's going on? And my trainer comes over and she puts on gloves and she grabs some tweezers and she's picking the parts away from the vaginal tissue. And I've never had anxiety before this at all. So I'm looking and I don't know what's going on. I had no idea this was what was going to be happening, especially my first day. And she has tweezers and she's like, okay, well, this is a head, this is the arm, this is a leg. And she hands them over. Oh, here you go. Can you show me some of the parts I just showed you? And then I see someone come in with a bottle of
Just amazing. Let's run the next one. And I want to play several of these and then we're going to break down and analyze in detail what they say. Let's play that next clip.
Intact?
These are intact kidneys, yes. So somebody needed...
Because if I looked at that, I'd be like...
In the upper corner, you can see a still of the baby parts. Arms, legs, eyes, head.
5 stars.
Yeah, you could start a neural cell culture from this neural tissue right here.
Like, would someone want that?
This?
Yeah.
Yeah. Someone would definitely. This
so
was,
even
this
though
is 11 definitely,
weeks, even though it's really early, because I know that's when we talked about.
This is neural tissue that people could take and look, and you see how it's still connected through the spinal cord back there. If you
do we just send that all together, and they pick it up.
You could actually, yeah. Yeah. Some people prefer that actually because it keeps it a little more protected. Yeah.
Okay. Now he goes on to say, the buyer says that 11.6. This 11.6 week old baby was pretty good. There were 3 or 4 samples we could have taken out of the 11.6. And then the doctor says, excellent. And then the buyer says, well, if we were doing like $50 to $75 per specimen, that'd be like $200 to $300 total. And we'd be comfortable with that. But stuff like this, we don't want to be like just like a flat fee of like $200. And then it's like, and then the doctor says, no. And they, I think a per item thing works a little better just because we can see how much we can get out of it. Don't tell me that they are not doing this for profit. Everybody can see that they are doing this for profit. This is not a question of a black market versus a gray area of the law. This is the difference as to whether or not our society can see the difference between right and wrong. Everybody comes to this from a different perspective. Many of us have been on the other side. Abby Johnson was on the other side. She even worked for Planned Parenthood. She thought she was helping people with birth control. She thought she was helping people make decisions to really do family planning. Instead, she realized they were pushing abortions. They were pushing infanticide. And then she saw that it was murder. I realized that this was murder when I got educated about partial birth abortion. Now America can see videos of babies in the womb with 4G ultrasound. They can see living babies in the womb. They know that this is not a non-human thing that is going through evolutionary stages, as we were told by Ernst Haeckler, the bulldog for Charles Darwin. He made up those drawings, folks. It's false. We have pictures now. He just invented all of that to push the theory of evolution. And now we've been told that these are not human, that at this one point, they're just fish. At this other point, they're birds or whatever. And then later on, they become human. But that doesn't stop them from aborting fully mature babies. That's outlawed, that partial birth abortion process. And yet they feel that they still have a gray area. Now, the question for America, now that you have 4G ultrasound, now that you have these undercover sting operations, and you can see that this is being run for profit, the question for America is, can you tell the difference between right and wrong?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that is the bottom line, that abortion has always been wrong, that Roe v. Wade was wrong. And I think it's time that we kind of force the government's hand. We're going to have to do it by the way that we vote. We're going to have to do it by our actions, by our money.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's what's going to make them pay attention
is
our money. And, you know, I, for one, am sick of my tax dollars being used to fund the killing of innocent life.
Yes. And I have to say, too, again, as we see in so many different issues, I don't know what your opinions are on this, Abby, but my opinions are on this, that Washington is just too far gone. We can have somebody like John Boehner who says that he doesn't have any facts. He's got the facts. He doesn't care about this. He can get all sentimental about his golf game, but he could care less about babies being chopped up and sold for money. We've got Mitch McConnell, who lies to people. Ted Cruz called him out on it, said, "You're a liar." And then they came back and said, "That's not according to that. You broke the rules of decorum for the Senate." And it's like, no, Mitch McConnell broke the rules of decorum for the Senate when he lied to voters, when he lied to his fellow senators. We got a few people like Cruz and Paul and Lee who want to do something about it, but the vast majority of Washington just isn't there. We can just forget about getting anything done at the national level. Quite personally, I mean, we have tried voting people in now, what, 40 years? We haven't had any success with that. We have had success at the local level. Mm-hmm. We can get things done at the local level. We can get things done at the state level. That's where every solution needs to be solved, is at the state and local level. We're not having any luck with Washington. Washington is nothing but a corrupt cancer. It is a black hole of financial interest that will do anything the corporatists want, in this case, the corporation called Planned Parenthood. They will give them anything that they want. So I think we're going to have to go to the state level. We're going to have to go to the local level. We're going to have to run these people out of business. Look, the city governments know how to put people they don't like out of business using city regulations. You can do that at a city-by-city level. You can get the right people in your city, and you can say, our city is not going to be a sanctuary city for infanticide. You can do that. You can elect the people at the local level much more easily than you can change this Republican Party, which is at the call of the and the behest of Planned Parenthood.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, look, yeah, I live in Austin, and we found out recently that the city of Austin was leasing a building to Planned Parenthood, a over 7,000 square foot facility, for $1 a year. For a 20-year lease, $1 a year. Now, that made me want to go, okay, well, I want to open up a pro-life center and go to the city and say, hey, look, I want that same deal that you gave Planned Parenthood. They would never mm-hmm. consider doing that for us, for a pro-life group who's actually wanting to save babies. Yet, you know, if you want to kill them, if you want to harvest their parts, then the city, they'll give you all the money that you want.
It's a massive subsidy. It's a massive subsidy. And if you can't stop this at the local level, if you can't get people out of the city of Austin who are leasing a 7,000 square foot building for $1 a year on a 20-year lease to Planned Parenthood to subsidize that, if you can't stop that in Austin, you're not going to be able to stop it in Washington. So get busy in Austin. Get busy in your local community. Make sure that this is something is done about it. You have the tools. You can show people what this is. There's no excuse for people being ignorant. We've got the tapes. We've got the video. We've caught them red-handed. We've caught them negotiating the price. We've caught them doing this for money. You, as well as many other people, have been telling us about it. Very much what you did reminds me of the NSA whistleblowers. Mm. I mean, we had people like William Binney that we've had on the show. Many others who for years were undergoing persecution. They came after Thomas Drake, tried to set him up, tried to get felony charges against him. Mm-hmm. Kirk Werby, we've talked to him, William Binney. They told Congress about it. They did it the right way. They went through the legal channels. They said, please do something about this. This is unconstitutional. It is very dangerous for the government to do this. Nobody did anything about it. It took the Snowden documents for people to wake up and understand, but still, like this, nothing is happening. We are at that moment now, just like we are with the Snowden documents. We know what the NSA is doing. We know the danger of the surveillance state, and we know now, there's no question about it, this is for-profit murder, a la carte baby parts for sale. This is abhorrent. It needs to be stopped. America has the information. Now, the question, the moral dilemma for America is, are you going to own this or are you going to change it? Because that's ultimately where it goes. It's just like we see in the Obama administration. If there's a massive persecution of the IRS of political opponents and the Obama administration doesn't do anything about it, then they own it. Just like Nixon owned the corruption of those people who worked for him. The buck stops there. Well, you know what? The buck stops with you, America, because you now have this information. What are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it in your community? If you've got a Planned Parenthood facility like we do here in Austin that's being subsidized by a corrupt government, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it in other areas? If you've got something in your state, do something about it at the state level. We've got to go to commercial break, but we're going to come back. We're going to continue to talk to Abby Johnson, Planned Parenthood whistleblower. And we're going to take another look at this video. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And joining me now is Abby Johnson. She's been with us throughout this hour. She was a former Planned Parenthood worker, now a whistleblower. She realized it was for profit. She realized that it was murder when she saw an ultrasound. And she's gone public about that. And she's having a big effect. And your site again is abortionworker.com. I want to go back and talk about something that she told me during the break about Senator Lee Bright in South Carolina, a bill that he was putting through regarding abortion there. Before we do, quickly, this hour, the Alex Jones Show is made possible by your support of the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, that is now in stock. It's the way we support this operation. We're very upfront about it. We want you to be able to take control of your life, take control of your health. Iodine is an essential nutrient that you need to have. It's no longer in many of the foods that it used to be supplemented in. Don't take our word for it. Look at the reviews that are there. There's over 400 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of the respondents would recommend it to a friend or family member. Right now it's in stock, and this month, in the month of July, we have free shipping on everything at InfoWarsLife.com. So it's a good time to stock up on not only Survival Shield X2, but Knockout, another one of our products. Anything that's there, you get free shipping in the month of July, and that only lasts for another 2 days. We're just a couple of days away from the month of July ending. Again, that's InfoWarsLife.com. That's how we support the operation. Abby, we were talking during the break about State Senator Lee Bright in South Carolina. He introduced a very stringent bill about fetal pain, was it? And you were telling me about the pushback that he got from inside the pro-life movement.
Right, yeah. I mean, we see corruption even inside the pro-life movement. We see people, pro-life organizations, who are constantly willing to accept these loopholes in bills. And, you know, we as conservatives, as pro-lifers, we have to be willing to fight against that. And Senator Lee Bright had, there was a bill that was coming up that would ban abortions past 20 weeks in South Carolina. It had an exception in it for rape. And he said, look, either they're always babies or they're never babies. They're not sometimes babies if the conception is ideal, right? Mm-hmm. And he said, plus, this is just a glaring loophole for the abortion industry to ram through. And he said, no, I'm not going to do it. And he said, I need pro-life organizations to support me.
Because they're going
to
say, in any particular case, that's their loophole. They can say, well, it was a case of rape.
Tell us it was rape.
Yeah, just tell us it was rape. Write that down here, sign that here, and you'll get your abortion.
And so, he said, no, we're not going to do it. So he stood strong against it and was asking pro-life groups to stand with him to get this amendment taken out and to have it as a no exceptions bill. And National Right to Life sent out his personal cell phone number to everybody on their list and said, you need to call him, admonish him, chastise him for holding up this bill. It is not sometimes we are our own worst enemy, and we need to stand united against abortion in all circumstances, not just sometimes, but always. And we need to be willing to make the personal sacrifice, you know, even when it's uncomfortable. When we moved to Austin from Bryan College Station, we actually live in Round Rock, and you know, I said at the time when we moved, Travis County was subsidizing abortions at Planned Parenthood through local tax dollars. And I said, I am not going to move to a county that pays for abortion. And so we chose to live in Williamson County where it wasn't. There was really a beautiful house in Austin that I wanted, but I said, no, I'm not going
to
do it.
You have to do that.
And we sent a letter to, you know, to the city council letting them know. And then eventually, not because of me, but because of many people, they ended up not funding it anymore.
And of course, they're still subsidizing it. As you pointed out, they gave a $1 lease on a 7,000 square foot facility. That's a 20-year lease. And when we talk about rape, let's understand that Planned Parenthood facilitates statutory rape all the time. They let young girls who have been raped statutorily because they're underage, they let them get abortions all the time and they don't report it to law enforcement. That's it for today. Join us tonight at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.